now that we're done with our experiment, it's time to look at all the data we collected and figure out the empirical formula of zinc iodide. In order to do that, we need two pieces of information. We need the mass of iodine that reacted, and we need the mass of zinc that reacted. In addition, since we're crunching all these numbers anyway, we're going to verify the law of conservation of mass. In order to do that, we need the mass of the zinc iodide. When I'm trying to figure out some of these values, and I'm looking back at my data sheet, it's important that I compare the different lines and really look for the differences between the two lines. So what I mean by that is, if I'm trying to figure out the mass of iodine that reacted, I can compare the first two lines. And what I like to do is cross out what's exactly the same. So both lines say the mass of the flask and the zinc. The only difference between these first two lines is the word iodine. The other important piece here is that iodine was our limiting reagent. The solution started with that purple brownish color, and then as we heated it, it turned colorless. And that was an indication, that was huge. That's how we know that the iodine all went into forming that product, that zinc iodide. So we can just subtract these two values and get the mass of the iodine that reacted. Next, we're going to figure out the mass of the zinc that reacted. I'm going to use a similar technique, just scanning through my lines here and looking for lines that contain zinc and lines that don't contain zinc. I need everything to cancel out except for the word zinc. So I'm looking at this first line here because it says mass of flask and zinc. And then I notice that this fourth data value says mass of flask and zinc after the reaction. This is a little bit different than the iodide one because zinc was our excess reagent. We don't care how much zinc we put in there in the first place. We only need how much zinc was actually used up when the zinc iodide was formed. And so by comparing the mass of the flask and the zinc before and the mass of the flask and the zinc after, we know how much zinc went into that zinc iodide. So I'm going to just subtract these two lines, that first line, put like a bigger star here, and that fourth line. Finally, for the mass of the zinc iodide, I have mass of beaker and zinc iodide, and I have the mass of the beaker. So again, comparing those lines, they both have the beaker in it, but the difference between those two lines is the zinc iodide. So if I subtract the line that says mass of beaker and the line that says mass of beaker and zinc iodide, that's going to give me the mass of my zinc iodide. I need to go ahead and do that. The other thing to notice here as I'm doing this calculation is that I'm trying to maintain the same number of decimal places throughout. And that's because of the law of sig figs when we're adding and subtracting. We have four decimal places with all of our masses. So even if I happen to get a zero in one of these values down here, I still need to maintain four decimal places. So I'm getting 0.6805 grams for the mass of my zinc iodide. In the second part of our calculation, we're going to work to determine the empirical formula of zinc iodide. In order to do that, we need to convert both the mass of iodine to moles of iodine and the mass of zinc to moles of zinc. Let's start with the mass of iodine. Since we had 0.5427 grams of iodine, we can divide by its molar mass. grams will cancel grams. We're left with moles. The calculation for zinc is very similar. I'm going to start with the mass of zinc that reacted. And I'm going to use my periodic table and look up the atomic mass of zinc. .1436 divided by 65.39 gives us 2.196 times 10 to the negative third moles of zinc. To establish the formula, we need to figure out the mole-to-mole ratio. What we need to do here is find the smallest mole value. Looks like we have less moles of zinc compared to the moles of iodine. Then we're going to divide all of the mole values by that smallest mole value. Any number divided by itself is 1. And over here I get 1.947. A formula is a whole number ratio. And since this is so close to 2, I feel comfortable rounding it up to 2. That might not work out in every single case. If you get a value like 1.5, then you have to double all of your mole values. However, we're close enough to 2 here, so we can round up to 2. What do we do with these values? So, because we know that we have a 1 here, we know that we have 1 mole of zinc for every 2 moles of iodine. So we have this formula. The 1 is understood, so I don't really need to write it with it. Instead, I'll write ZnI2. And that'll be my answer. At this point, you might be wondering, why did we calculate the mass of zinc iodide that was formed? Well, knowing this value will allow us to look more closely at the law of conservation of mass. The law of conservation of mass tells us that matter can't be created and matter can't be destroyed. So for this experiment, that means that the mass of iodine that we put in the beaker plus the mass of zinc that reacted should equal the mass of zinc iodide product that was formed. Let's evaluate. So I added 0.5427 grams of iodide, and we had 0.1436 grams of zinc used up throughout the experiment. If I add those two values, I get 0.6863 grams. We compare the expected value to the actual value of product that was formed. We see that they're really close. They just vary by the thousandths place, which tells us two things. One, the law of conservation of mass has been followed. And two, we have minimal error in our experiment. There is a little bit, but it's nothing major.